Good evening, everybody. Welcome to the final lecture for the 2004 symposium for MUFON held here in Denver, Colorado. It's going to have a heck of a close, just like it had a heck of an opening and a heck of a middle. Mr. Paul DAVIDS had started researching the UFO phenomenon, like many in the field, by his own sighting in the year of 1987. Some of you may have seen the Martin Sheen film called Roswell many years ago. Well, Paul DAVIDS, who is coming up next, was the executive producer on that. He does have a long line of credits in Hollywood, also writing many Star Wars books, and his resume is very, very impressive. Without going and wasting any more of Paul's time, let me get him up here so he has as much time as possible. Mr. Paul DAVIDS.
Thank you for that introduction, John. It's a great pleasure to be here, and thank you for your patience in still being here for the final presentation for this year's International MUFON UFO Symposium. The first symposium I attended was in Nebraska. I believe it was in 1989. I was very new to the field at that point. I'd had a UFO sighting 2 years earlier, in 1987, I met a number of debunkers there, including Philip Klass, who a lot of you may remember in this field. And I thought that at that time that he was perhaps just a sincere but misguided person who hadn't heard that UFOs are real from the right person yet. And I decided to tell him. That began a long association, primarily a one-way association with Philip Klass, in which I would get letters from him every few months, sending me ads from toy catalogs suggesting that what I had seen may have been a toy helium balloon or that sort of propeller-driven party toy. So we don't hear much from Phil Klass now. He's retired and I hear not doing too well. And I don't think there are as many debunkers in the field as there were. So with a clear field and a clear view to give you the presentation of my story, I'd like to begin. I'd like to ask that we put the computer images up on the screen and we'll stay with this. How do we, oh, we need to get a full screen on this. No. I keep getting smaller and smaller here.
There you go.
All right, now.
Okay, and then click slideshow. Or right here. That works.
Okay, so just click it twice.
Use show. There you go. Click on that little thing right there.
There?
No, right to the left. There you go. There you go.
Success. Let's see. I call this presentation Profiles in UFO Courage. I'm going to talk about a lot of people who I feel have been courageous in this field in stepping forward, in sticking their neck out and risking debunking and ridicule and a lot of the other things that have gone with this territory for so long. You may notice that I will not be primarily talking about witnesses and experiencers because I focus this presentation primarily on people in public life. I'm going to be talking about some celebrities who you know of. We're going to talk a lot about what Hollywood has done in connection with this field. We're going to talk about politics, literature, journalism, the astronauts. I've called the talk Profiles in UFO Courage based on the inspiration of the John F. Kennedy book, Profiles in Courage, which I'd like to make you aware, the first draft of it, the majority of the first draft of it, was written by my father. That's Dr. Jules Davids of Georgetown University, the late Dr. Jules Davids. My dad passed away in 96. This book, Profiles in Courage, won a Pulitzer Prize for John F. Kennedy. And the stature it built for him helped secure him the Democratic presidential nomination, and it helped contribute to his victory in his race for the White House. My dad was a noted scholar of American history. As I said, professor at Georgetown University, School of Foreign Service. And you can see my dad there off to the right. That was a typewriter, a manual typewriter he used for writing a lot of Profiles in Courage when I was a very young boy. He essentially became a secret writer for JFK because his contribution wasn't acknowledged for a long time. The picture off to the right is my dad's high school graduation picture. And at the left, you see him with Jacqueline Kennedy, young Jacqueline Kennedy, who was then married to JFK, in his class at Georgetown. She had enrolled in a graduate program given by my dad, in which my dad gave lectures in political courage. I want to say right from the beginning that this focus on political courage at MUFON's International UFO Symposium is because I think that this is the main thing that has been lacking in our effort and desire and our need to have disclosure and to hear from officials and our government the truth about this subject. What's lacking is courage. This book, Profiles in Courage, was a study in rare acts of courage, and that's what we need today. So I want to talk a little bit more about the book and a little bit about how I got into the field, and we're going to talk about some of the people in public life who have shown courage on the UFO subject. This is the preface to Profiles in Courage. And you'll notice in the third paragraph down, my dad is mentioned. I want to substantiate this for you. You don't have any question about it. Professor Jules Davids of Georgetown assisted materially in the preparation of several chapters. It didn't say he wrote the first draft of 5 of the 9 chapters, but that was his contribution. This was JFK's letter to my dad, indicating that he hoped to meet with him in the not-too-distant future. This was January 15th of 1955, and this was the prelude to their working together. This was a 2-page handwritten note my dad received from JFK in March of 1955 when Kennedy learned from Ted Sorensen that my dad would arrange his schedule in order to assist in the preparation of the book. This was page 1. My dad had sent a memorandum, a proposal. JFK said he thought it was excellent and should prove most beneficial. I will be in touch with you, he said. I look forward to seeing you in April. This was in Parade magazine, where someone wrote into Walter Scott's personality parade asking, who really wrote Profiles in Courage? And the reply was, from all accounts, Profiles in Courage was largely a collaborative effort in which key roles were played by Ted Sorensen, who was Kennedy's legislative assistant when Kennedy was a US senator, Dr. Jules Davids, whose history class Jackie Kennedy attended at Georgetown University, and John F. Kennedy. Sorensen and Davids did most of the writing, and Kennedy oversaw the work. This was the thank you letter from JFK to my dad after the book came out, in which he says, thank you for your assistance in writing the book. At around that time, JFK was nominated. And columnist Drew Pearson had caught wind of the fact that perhaps JFK wasn't the sole author of the book. It's contrary to the rules of the Pulitzer Prize Committee to give to accept a Pulitzer Prize if it's a collaborative effort, a committee-written book, or a ghost-written book. JFK did accept the Pulitzer Prize, and Drew Pearson got my father's name, called him, and tried to get a statement from him, which could have been damaging to JFK's run for the White House. And my father did not provide him with any information. So the extent of my dad's contribution was, for many years, something he didn't publicly divulge. He didn't want to do anything that might negatively impact the Democrats' effort to defeat Richard Nixon in 1960. He was a good Democrat. And from my point of view, this helped me become aware at a very young age that secrets are sometimes kept for political reasons. As I said, political courage is an important issue for our times because there's so little of it. It's also an important issue for everyone in the field of ufology today. It takes courage to work to create public awareness of unexplained phenomena seen in the skies, because UFO sightings always have been officially debunked and ridiculed. It takes courage to try to unravel what nuclear physicist Stanton Friedman, who was honored this year at this symposium, called the cosmic Watergate. Thus, Stanton Friedman coined the term often used to describe the officially sanctioned suppression of evidence about unidentified flying objects, evidence that might reveal their origins, purposes, potential, and possible implications for the transformation of mankind's future. My dad had persuaded JFK that Profiles in Courage should focus on courageous acts by senators. The four senators he dealt with were Daniel Webster, Sam Houston, Lucius Lamar, and George Norris. And he also provided an essay on the meaning of political courage that became the foundation for the conclusion of the book. So the central point of Profiles in Courage was that occasionally in American history, one finds acts of outstanding courage by senators, where a position a senator takes is contrary to his personal interests, contrary to the interests of his state, and contrary to the interests of the constituents that elected him. Yet he takes a very difficult and controversial position for what he perceives as the larger good of the country. I've been involved with ufology now for 17 years, first as a witness, then as a very avid researcher and reader in the field, and finally as the executive producer and co-writer of the film Roswell. Not to be confused with the television series, this preceded the series, it was the Showtime television movie about the Roswell incident. Thank you. During that period of time, I've become firmly convinced that the secrecy, deception, obfuscation, and official denial surrounding the issue of UFOs for over 50 years is detrimental to the larger good of our country. The case is closed, say the officials, dismissing every incident everywhere in the world, regardless of the nature of the evidence. But no matter how many times they say it, the case is not closed, and the case never will be closed until our leaders address the truth and make it known. Today, we look for examples of courage on the UFO issue in the Senate, and we find a baked and parched desert without even a gentle breeze stirring. How important is this issue to mankind's present and future? Captain Kevin Randall of the US Air Force, a UFO author, said it best in an episode of the TV series Unsolved Mysteries, when he commented on the testimony of Mrs. Sappho Henderson in the Roswell UFO case. Mrs. Henderson said that 30 years after the incident, her husband, a flight commander of 29 military planes, a man who had kept many of our country's deepest secrets, finally confided in her that an ET spaceship did crash at Roswell in 1947, and that her husband was the pilot who flew the bodies of the deceased aliens to Wright-Patterson Air Force Base in Ohio. I'd like you to see a little clip from Unsolved Mysteries. I'm having a problem if someone could help me technically here because I don't have the I don't have my arrow. No. I want to play this, the clip. And I don't have the arrow. They're saying I'm in slide mode and I need to get out of slide mode to do that. A right click. Now we're way down in the presentation now. Could you come up and help out? I'm sorry we're having this technical problem. I'm a little new to PowerPoint, but hopefully we'll get past this. I need to go back one. There. That's where I want to be. Now how do I get it to show? See, I don't have an arrow on there. Ah, there it is. Okay. All right, we're okay. Hopefully we won't have this problem again.
My husband, Oliver Henderson, otherwise known as Pappy in the Air Force, he was entrusted with many of this country's top secrets, and they were safe with him. He never told anything that he wasn't supposed to. And therefore, it was 34 years after this incident happened that I heard about it.
Captain Pappy Henderson was the man who piloted the plane that took the first pieces of wreckage out of Roswell. In 1981, 2 years before he died, he told his wife that in spite of military denials, the Roswell incident really happened.
My husband told me the bodies were small, smaller than human bodies. The heads were larger, and the eyes were rather sunken and a little slanted. Clothing was of material unlike anything he'd seen before. They were strange. They were not of this earth. When my husband, who was a man of truth, who was trusted with 29 different Army aircraft planes, first pilot, aircraft commander, tells me this story, I believed him.
If this happened, it's the most significant event of the 20th century and probably the millennium. It would be akin to Columbus discovering the New World and Queen Isabella deciding not to tell the rest of the world about the discovery of the New World.
I really appreciated that quote from Kevin. He did qualify his assessment with the words, if true. Unfortunately, we don't have access to whatever physical evidence may exist that could prove Sappho Henderson's claim. We have her word for it, and we now have a very substantial database of similar testimony dealing not only with Roswell, but with close encounters of every kind, from the days of Roswell incident in 1947 to the present. We also have testimony from distinguished persons that such evidence does exist, but that it's very highly classified and it will not be released to anyone who does not have the need to know. Whatever the true nature of our reality, mankind has always lived with the belief that people have the right to know it. Otherwise, the story of Galileo's persecution repeats itself endlessly from generation to generation. The true answer to the question of whether the Earth revolves around the sun was a sort of matter of national security for the powerful Catholic Church of Galileo's era. Is this where we are today with the issue of intelligent extraterrestrial life? Are we all under a sort of house arrest like Galileo was for our audacity in wanting fact and not fiction from our leaders and our media about this issue? Wherever we turn on the issue of UFOs and ET contact, as I say, there have been precious few examples of courage by anyone in public life, in politics, or in the Senate or Congress. There have been a few exceptions, though. Three of them would be Senator Barry Goldwater, Congressman Gerald Ford, and New Mexico Congressman, the late Stephen Schiff. I might include as number four Senator Strom Thurmond, whose courage lasted for about one day. Any discussion of profiles in UFO courage should probably begin with Senator Barry Goldwater, who released public statements and letters to constituents, as well as several statements in video interviews, which inform us that he believed there was a crash of an alien spaceship at Roswell, New Mexico, and that he believed debris and remains had been taken to a so-called blue room at Wright-Patterson Air Force Base. Goldwater has also told the public that he was prevented from seeing it or inquiring any further by General Curtis LeMay. I have a video of a statement that Barry Goldwater made to Larry King on a Larry King special called UFO Cover-Up, live from Area 51.
I can't back that up, but I think that at Wright-Patterson Field, if you could get into certain places, you'd find out what the Air Force and the government knows about UFOs.
From his ham radio shack outside Phoenix, the senator disclaims direct knowledge of UFOs, but he does confirm a disturbing story about an exchange with General Curtis LeMay.
Reportedly, a spaceship landed. It was all hushed up, quieted, and nobody ever, I've never heard about much of it. I called Curtis LeMay and I said, General, I know we have a room at Wright-Patterson where you put all this secret stuff. Could I go in there? I've never heard him get mad, but he got madder than hell at me, cussed me out, said, don't ever ask me that question again.
We're still asking it. Barry Goldwater is no longer with us, unfortunately. As a Michigan congressman, Gerald Ford called for an investigation of UFOs by Congress after he heard swamp gas offered as an official explanation by Air Force consultant Dr. J. Allen Hynek to dismiss extensive UFO sightings in Gerald Ford's home state. However, when Ford became president, his courage was gone. And as far as I know, he never mentioned the issue publicly again. We've lost the sound now.
Initiated the first congressional hearings that contained portions that were open to the public.
Congress wanted a fresh look into UFOs, an objective scientific investigation that would be completely independent of the Air Force. In charge was a physicist at the University of Colorado, Dr. Edward Condon. Many people had high hopes that this would finally be an in-depth, serious scientific study. But when the Condon report came out, the UFO community was outraged.
We find this Condon report incredible.
I would label as prejudiced.
Really, it's a lot of nonsense.
This report covers only about 3% of the evidence that was made available to them.
There is a very large, overwhelming majority of the significant case material that has not even been confronted.
It evades a number of cases in which the Air Force itself said there was no explanation.
Dr. Condon and his group was given an unprecedented opportunity to clarify the UFO problem that's puzzled so many of us for a long time. He wasted that opportunity.
That was Dr. James McDonald. Ann Druffel has written an extraordinary book about him called Firestorm, I believe. Congressman Stephen Schiff of New Mexico showed courage in demanding answers from the Pentagon about the Roswell incident. He eventually received a report that blamed the so-called Roswell quote-unquote myth on a New York University balloon research project called Mogul. Then came another report that explained the alien bodies as sightings of Air Force crash dummies that were dropped from planes years after the Roswell incident occurred. Congressman Schiff died an untimely death, apparently of natural causes, before he could ask any more questions. And no one else since then in Congress or the Senate has yet dared touch the hot potato. This is a news report that came out at the time covering the Schiff investigation. Well, we're trying.
For those of you who believe in visitors from outer space, well, some discouraging news.
They've used clips from my film Roswell.
When Nightly News continues in a moment.
The case here.
We'll have the space shuttle liftoff, and also, was it a cover-up of UFOs? The government says no way. And in the skies over the West Coast this morning, an unidentified speeding light and apparently a sonic boom. Many saw it, but there's been no official explanation. Well, maybe they should ask the Pentagon in, about 47 years. NBC's Jim Mikloszewski tonight on the Air Force fessing up almost a half century after another UFO.
Stories about UFOs and aliens swooping down from outer space have long captured our imagination, especially the Roswell incident. 47 years ago, something crashed into the desert outside Roswell, New Mexico. And for 47 years, the Pentagon lied about it. Eyewitnesses had reported debris from a flying disc scattered over two-thirds of a mile. Some stories included the bodies of four-foot-tall aliens, crew members killed in the extraterrestrial crash. The Pentagon denied it was a UFO and claimed the debris came from a military weather balloon.
But the Air Force now says it wasn't a weather balloon after all, but a top-secret balloon to spy on the Soviets. That would appear to explain all the Pentagon's secrecy, right? Wrong.
Oh, my God. This thing was big.
As depicted in a recent movie, several witnesses claim the military forced them to change their stories and hide the evidence. Walter Haught was an airman in Roswell at the time and now runs a UFO museum.
I think that the comments are simply another cover-up.
Some UFO buffs believe the military covered it up to protect against public panic because they couldn't explain it.
Perhaps alien and non-human. Something not made by any power on this earth.
The government contends most UFO sightings can be explained, but out of the thousands reported over the years, one out of 10 remains a mystery. As for Roswell, the case is not closed. The General Accounting Office will release its own report soon.
The decision rests with you.
Jim Mikloszewski, NBC News, Washington.
And there you have it, true lies, as the... as the caption said at the beginning. I said I was going to mention Strom Thurmond in connection with UFO courage. He wrote a laudatory foreword about Colonel Philip Corso, which was published in the first edition of the book, co-authored by Corso, called The Day After Roswell. The foreword established that the senator thought a great deal of Colonel Corso, whom he praised as a loyal and a great American. Soon after publication, however, Strom Thurmond's courage evaporated, as his staff demanded that the foreword be removed in all future editions, and that the edition that was in the bookstores at that time be immediately removed from it. Strom Thurmond publicly claimed he never knew the book had anything to do with UFOs. Corso responded by saying that that statement was false and that Senator Thurmond was covering himself when he caught hell after the balloon had popped. So part of the reason for the lack of forthrightness by congressmen, senators about UFOs might have to do with how one defines courage on this issue at any particular moment in history. For decades, most people in official capacities who had been ordered not to talk felt that it was the courageous thing to do, the patriotic thing to do, to remain silent because they had been told that national security was at stake. And we do know for a fact that people have been ordered not to talk because many of them have since revealed it, including military men who were at Roswell in July of 1947, civilian airplane pilots, and astronaut Gordon Cooper in recorded interviews. So initially, secrecy may have been regarded as a duty, an act of loyalty. But my question now is, at this 35th MUFON Symposium, how many years does Queen Isabella get to deny that Columbus ever found a new world before some of those in her court who know the truth will be considered courageous for being whistleblowers? Philip Corso with with the general under whose command that he served. In my father's essay for JFK on the meaning of political courage, there were a couple of points that bear upon this issue. In the mid-1950s, writing about political courage, my father wrote about how large societies such as the USSR and the USSR and the US deal with what he called factions. A faction within the culture is a sort of subculture that doesn't go along with the prevailing norms, that has its own agenda. A faction has its own point of view that may upset the status quo or be seen as a threat. And I think it's clear that one could call the so-called UFO community, advocates for UFO disclosure, a faction within US society. These were some of the points that my dad made about political courage, in which he talked about how the countries deal with factions, that in the USSR, a communist society, they dealt with the factions by destroying all liberty. There was no liberty to assemble as a UFO group for many decades in the USSR. They wouldn't let such groups gather or hold meetings. In the United States, the prevailing way of dealing with factions, according to my father, has been an inclination by the government and the media, often working hand in hand, to create conformity. That would mean conformity of behavior and point of view by giving every citizen the same opinions, the same passions, the same interests. That's the quote from my father's essay for JFK. This is what we've seen in operation in the official denials on UFOs and the ridicule, the ostracizing of witnesses, and the personal attacks on individuals who make certain claims. Steve Bassett talked about this in terms of landing in the ghetto, that they ghettoized the faction. For several decades, it became a mainstream belief in psychology that people who claimed to see UFOs had psychological problems, ghettoizing them even more, and creating a damaging stigma against witnesses who wanted to go public. Prevailing opinion, reinforced for decades, even with the help of Walter Cronkite of CBS in an early duplicitous network documentary that Leslie Kane had something to say about when she was talking about the Robertson Committee and the debunking that was cooperated in by CBS. The prevailing opinion had been that there is nothing to cover up, that there's no reason to classify anything on this subject. A series of pat answers was developed by the society at large to deal with every witness and every claim. And we've heard those answers many times. It's all a hoax. The photos are fakes. None of the witnesses are telling the truth. The witnesses cannot be relied upon, or the witnesses are making honest mistakes, and the documents they are citing are forgeries. Or the so-called witnesses are communists or political agitators trying to infuse fear and confusion for political reasons. Whatever the reason cited, it always ended with case closed. Then along came videotape, digital cameras, and the internet. There's no longer a need to develop film negatives that can be snatched by men in black. Some UFO events are videotaped by dozens of people. For example, plenty of cases from Mexico, including the military sighting that has been much discussed at this conference. Actually, it was a sighting of the many UFOs recently by a plane looking for growing illegal plants for drugs on the ground. And the videotape was released by the Mexican military. Now, if you can't find the evidence broadcast on network TV, you can still order it up if you take the time from companies like Tim Crawford's UFO TV. Or the evidence can be spread throughout the world by email with the click of a mouse. However, deliberate hoaxes are still perpetrated for the purpose of causing confusion and to discredit. For a government that used to have don't ask, don't tell as its method of dealing with the UFO issue, today ambiguity is the best policy. Fact and fiction intermingled, so the public can't tell one from the other. By the way, Jackie Kennedy wasn't the only famous student my dad had along the way. This man was one of his students back in 1968, young Bill Clinton. My own evolution of awareness on this issue, I think, is a microcosm of a shifting awareness by the public at large. In my younger years, I was a skeptic on the UFO issue, as was my father. I went to college at Princeton, where I was taught mainstream and rather conservative views. But then I departed the East Coast for Hollywood, gaining a small foothold in the entertainment business in the late 1970s, after studying at the American Film Institute Center for Advanced Film Studies in Beverly Hills. Professionally, I progressed from being a script reader to a TV producer. My first TV producing job was with F. Lee Bailey. I was a segment producer on a TV series called Lie Detector. It turned out that Betty Hill, the first woman in the US to publicly claim having been abducted by aliens, was on our show, Lie Detector. In those days, I was close-minded to the subject. Betty Hill did pass her polygraph on the show, and that really surprised me, but it didn't make me believe in aliens. It made me wonder how she beat the polygraph. I went from that show to working as production coordinator of The Transformers, the animated series based on the Hasbro toys. A lot of you may have kids who absolutely grew up on these toys. There were 150 or so of them. And I was production coordinator for over 80 of the shows. I wrote about four of them. But when my work on that series was done, along came one of the most fateful days of my life in February, February 25th, 1987. At 4:30, at about 4:30 in the afternoon, my daughter, who was then 9 years old, screamed at me from the second floor of our house, "Daddy, get upstairs right now. I see a flying saucer." I was a bit slow to react. Without looking, I was sure that whatever she was seeing had to be a Goodyear blimp or something mundane like that. I called out to her that she should take another look and be sure that it wasn't a blimp. She'd interrupted me a couple of times already that afternoon, and I didn't welcome being interrupted again. But she screamed at me, "No, Daddy, I mean it. Get up here right now. I see a flying saucer." These are my notes on what happened next. I didn't even take a camera upstairs, so low were my expectations. But I saw that flying saucer in broad daylight, as God is my witness, for about 5 minutes from out on my roof, first from inside her bedroom looking out the window, then out on the roof. My six-year-old son joined us. It descended from high in the sky and approached to within what was probably a few hundred feet of us, somewhere between a few hundred feet and 1,000 feet. At one point, it seemed to be aware of us by its movements behind trees as it hovered in an open space between the branches so that it remained perfectly visible to us while it was framed by leaves around it. It was silent, it had no propellers, no exhaust of any kind, and it oscillated slowly and uniformly around the vertical axis when it hovered. It didn't appear to oscillate when it flew horizontally. It was, I believe, larger than a Volkswagen, smaller than a helicopter. It was a perfectly circular dome disk, metallic in appearance, a sort of dull pewter silver, reflecting the orange glint of the sun off of its rim. The sun was getting very low and about to go over the hills of Mount Washington across the way. We're up on a hill, the next hill over from Mount Washington. It seemed identical in many respects to many of the dome disks that people throughout the world had been reporting since World War II, but I didn't know that then. I really knew nothing about the field at all, apart from my personal interest in flying saucers as science fiction. The effect that this close sighting had on me was profound. The details have been written up and addressed elsewhere. I've written about the incident in the International UFO Reporter of the J. Allen Hynek Center for UFO Studies. This cover of the May-June 1989 issue shows what we saw from our roof at one point, where it was the cover story. And alongside that is a write-up about the case that was done by the Center for UFO Studies by Don Schmidt out of Chicago. This was a drawing of what we saw that was done by my daughter. You see the three of us there on the roof. There's a ladder that one of us is by that would go to the very top of the roof where we have a another observation deck up there at the top, but we didn't actually climb up to that next level. We were on the second floor roof. And this was my son's drawing. He's got the time. He didn't write the date. I had to write the date in alongside that, but he drew little squiggles around the flying saucer to he said it was to convey the fact that it had this little wobble to it, while it hoovered, as my daughter said, instead of hovered. I thought you'd enjoy seeing this. I filmed my son's testimony about it just shortly after it happened.
Well, I was downstairs playing videos, and my sister Jordan shouted out to me and my dad, "Scott, Dad, I see a flying saucer." And so we ran upstairs and we watched it a tiny, tiny bit in here. And then we climbed out on the roof and we looked at it for 2 to 3 minutes. And it was a medium size. And it had a dome on top, sort of like Saturn, but no dome on the bottom. And it was a strange object, something that I've never seen before. There was no noise. It couldn't be a balloon, couldn't be a helicopter. It couldn't be an airplane. It couldn't be a train. It was just a strange object.
I'm sure you're all very relieved to know that it couldn't have been a train. It was about a month or so after that sighting that Bill Clinton, who was then governor of Arkansas, wrote his first letter reconnecting with my father since he'd been my dad's student in 1968. We still have one of Bill Clinton's term papers from back then, by the way. So this gesture on his part sort of opened up a family connection with him again. And you'll see as I proceed with this that I later wrote three letters to Bill Clinton myself, all of which got a personal response, and one of which was about Roswell and UFOs. Following that sighting, I talked to a lot of people about it. I talked to one scientist from JPL who had worked on the Mars Mariner mission, and he actually came over to my house, and I was able to point out to him where we saw it, how it behaved, what happened. He was baffled. I asked him, you know, is JPL building anything that they're testing over my neighborhood? You know, something classified, but if it was classified, you couldn't tell me. And he said, you know, if JPL was doing something like that and it was classified, you know, I'd give you a hint. You know, it wasn't that, no. So then I had a chance to talk to director Robert Wise about it, who made the film The Day the Earth Stood Still. He had become a family friend, and he told me that he was very serious about the subject because in making that film and in the aftermath about it, he'd heard about credible sightings from very reliable people. He said he couldn't understand why the authorities might be covering this up, but if they were, he absolutely didn't feel it was right that there was any justifiable excuse for it. Any. Nothing. He recommended that I... I have an hour and a half. Yeah, we got 45 minutes more to go. He recommended that I talk to Roy Thinnes, who was a star as a UFO investigator in a 1960 series called The Invaders. Roy Thinnes took the subject very seriously for the same reasons Robert Wise did. And he came out to my home. I walked him through what had happened. He wrote this letter to Don Schmidt at the Center for UFO Studies, and that was my first connection with the center in Chicago. I hadn't heard about it before then. So Don Schmidt came out to my home. As I said, he did a report for KUFOS. We stayed in touch during the following 2 years, and he told me he was writing a book with Kevin Randall about the Roswell incident, that they were doing their own investigation. And that's when I made a deal with them to option the rights to their as of yet unwritten book. They had a 17-page outline. For $25, I held the rights on that book for a number of years. We made a deal with HBO first. After rejections everywhere for a couple of years, I got director Jeremy Kagan involved, a great director, did The Journey of Natty Gann and The Chosen. He set up a deal at HBO. We were rewriting the script, working with playwright Arthur Copet for a year and a half. We were right up to the point where we were going to cast it and go ahead with the movie, and then HBO killed it. Told us that they decided to make only one movie about UFOs in that year, that they were going to make the remake, The Attack of the 50-Foot Woman with Daryl Hannah. And that killed Roswell at HBO. I was very dismayed, but 6 months later, we had resold it to Showtime, who bought out HBO. We got a very different response at Showtime. They were enthusiastic. They decided to make it. And we were able to cast Kyle MacLachlan as Jesse Marcel, Dwight Yoakam as Mac Brazel. Martin Sheen played a government secret agent. And finally, after we shot the film in 93, it came out in 94. On national TV, and this was the preview for it. Well, let's go back.
On July 4th,
1947, it's alien technology. We haven't learned how to back engineer it.
New Mexico. It was so unbelievable.
This just in.
It's flying saucer.
There was only one thing the government could do.
I don't understand. This is a weather balloon.
This is what you found.
Kyle MacLachlan.
I'm the fall guy on this. I want to know what for.
Martin Sheen in a Showtime original movie, Roswell.
What if people think that we are not in control of the skies?
They'd be right.
Well, it made quite a splash, but its release was timed for the Air Force's releasing of their report saying that it was only a Mogul balloon. I mean, I'm not saying that the timing was exactly orchestrated, but Colonel Weaver of the U.S. Air Force signed the report declaring Roswell was a Mogul balloon 3 days before our movie hit national television. And there was a press conference at the Air Force to release that information about 6 weeks after our film came out. I guess the motivation was to cast a lot of doubt upon what we'd portrayed in our film. But finally, President Clinton was asked a question about it at a press conference when he was over in Ireland. And here's what he said.
As far as I know, an alien spacecraft did not crash in Roswell, New Mexico in 1947.
Now, everyone laughed, but the TV news cut off the second half of his answer to the question. What he What he said was, as far as I know, no spaceship crashed in Roswell, New Mexico in 1947. Everybody laughed, and then he said, but if a spaceship did crash and aliens were recovered there, the Air Force hasn't told me about it, and I would like to know. That didn't get on the television news, you know, and he may have been telling him the truth because it may not have been the Air Force that told him about it. There's a lot of agencies in government that might have brought it up. He didn't mention that. He did say he'd like to know, so I figured, well, I had written, this is Bill Clinton in Ireland on that trip. I had written two previous letters to him which had drawn a response. This was Bill Clinton's first response to me when he was running for president. I had written him a letter of support, telling him about some Star Wars books that I was writing, and he wrote me a nice letter. And then when the books came out in 92, I sent him the Star Wars books and some photographs of my family and my dad, and he sent me a nice letter. So I wrote him this two-page letter. I found out what channels I would have to go through to make sure my letter would get through to the president. In which I was asking him to really get to the bottom of the Roswell incident. I wasn't accepting the Air Force mogul balloon report, and I wanted more answers. I sent him the film Roswell. I sent him a few documentaries that I had made on the subject, and I noted that he had been instrumental in declassifying some important things, and I asked him if he would follow the lead of Lawrence Rockefeller and others of stature, including astronaut Gordon Cooper, do what they now publicly recommend and really declassify the information on UFOs. Oh, I also sent him this. In the Daily News, they had Lawrence Rockefeller, the alien from our film Roswell, and Bill Clinton all together there. So I thought that that might make a point. The timing of his reply letter to me was kind of interesting because he wrote it just the day before Richard Hoagland held a well-publicized news conference in Washington accusing NASA of withholding evidence of structures on the moon and archaeological ancient artifacts from an alien race on Mars. And the president mailed me the letter, priority mail from the White House, the day after that press conference. His previous letters had come with a first class stamp. This one was for some reason overnighted to me, and he never mentioned UFOs or the Roswell case. He said, "Thanks for the video cassettes. You were kind to pass them along, and I'm grateful for your generosity and thoughtfulness." Hillary joins me in sending best wishes, and that was it. But you've heard from Grant Cameron about what was going on behind the scenes in the Clinton administration around that time, and that might provide a little bit more insight on what was happening. So then, instead of further declassifications about the incident, we got this report about the crash dummies with the conjecture that that explained the alien bodies at Roswell. This was Hoagland at his press conference. I think he had worked for CBS News. I think he took a courageous stand by taking the case to Washington. He was ridiculed. He was debunked. The Washington Post put him in the style section and said his theories were as full of holes as green Swiss cheese. But they never really dealt with any of the of his suggestions or proposals. Sarah McClendon was the only person in the Washington, D.C. press corps who supported Richard Hoagland and came out publicly to do that, and that took courage on her part. Webster Hubble, it took courage on his part to admit in his book publicly that when he was sent over to the Justice Department, as the number three man there, President Clinton had asked him to find out the answer to two things: who killed JFK and are there UFOs? And just telling us that created a storm among the establishment media. Lawrence Rockefeller, certainly showed courage in sponsoring a serious study of UFOs that summarized the best evidence, the best cases, and having it privately printed and distributed only to Congress. When the Crash Dummies report came out, Sam Donaldson, who is a graduate of the New Mexico Military Institute in Roswell, showed courage in not buying it. He actually said in an interview with one of the Pentagon spokesmen, do you actually expect the American people to believe this? It was a courageous thing for him to do. John Podesta, we just heard a lot about what he's doing from Leslie Kane. I won't dwell on that. You know that after finishing his role as White House Chief of Staff and Assistant to the President under Clinton, that he has now been attempting to assist in obtaining documents related to the Kexburg case and I believe other cases. Larry King has played a very special role in these efforts because he has consistently enabled proponents on UFOs, people who accept the extraterrestrial answer, to come on his show and state their case. There's been no debunking from him, no smirking. He's taken it all very seriously, and he has helped in putting the heat on. And for that, he is to be singled out as one of the few in the media who has done that. George Knapp, he was reporting on UFOs out of Las Vegas. He was the first to bring us Bob Lazar, who first appeared on his show under a pseudonym, Dennis, I think it was, making extraordinary claims. To this day, we don't know where the truth is and whether there's fabrication in Bob Lazar's story. We do know there seems to be a problem in his presentation of his own background because a lot of the things he's claimed about his education don't add up. We don't know quite what to make of it. We don't know how much of it is true or false, but nevertheless, it was courageous of George Knapp to be the only person to step forward to bring this information forward.
Side ever talked publicly about the saucer stories?
Well, there are several, actually nine flying saucers, flying discs, that are out there of extraterrestrial origin.
The live interview with the shadowy Dennis drew international attention. Portions were broadcast by radio in six European countries and in a nationally televised TV special in Japan.
Actually, nine flying saucers, flying discs.
Despite numerous inquiries and feelers, Dennis has remained anonymous until now. His real name is Robert Lazar, a young scientist with eclectic interests. The choice of Dennis was an inside joke. He says that's the name of his superior at Groom Lake. It wasn't a joke to Dennis.
He called right after and he said, "Do you have any idea what we're going to do to you now?" And I said, "Well, no." And he hung up the phone.
Lazar's story is, by any standards, fantastic. He says he's telling it in order to protect himself. He says he was hired to work at an area called S4, which is a few miles south of Groom Lake. At S4, he says, are flying saucers, antimatter reactors, and other working examples of technology that is seemingly beyond human capabilities.
Right, this came from somewhere else. I mean, as bizarre as that is to believe, but I mean, it's there, I saw it. I know what the current state of the art is in physics, and it can't be done.
Checking out Lazar's credentials proved to be a difficult task. He says he earned degrees in physics and electronics, but the schools we contacted say they've never heard of him. He also said he worked as a physicist at Los Alamos National Lab, where he experimented with one of the world's largest particle beam accelerators, a half-mile-long behemoth capable of generating 700 million volts. Los Alamos officials told us they had no records of a Robert Lazar ever working there. They were either mistaken or were lying. A 1982 phone book from the lab lists Lazar right there among the other scientists and technicians. A 1982 clipping from the Los Alamos newspaper profiled Lazar and his interest in jet cars. It, too, mentioned his employment at the lab as a physicist. We called Los Alamos again. An exasperated official told us he still had no records on Lazar. EG&G, which is where Lazar says he was interviewed for the job at S4, also has no records. It's as if someone has made him disappear.
Well, they're trying to make me a non-person.
David Garcia, they call him Earthman David Garcia, a reporter for Fox News out of Los Angeles, has consistently played the UFO story with a positive and serious spin. No smirks, no debunking, no ridicule, just a demand for answers. And he brought us this of...
E.T. among us. Some people in the desert seem to think so. And
Area 51.
And we ask them for their evidence next.
Okay, finally tonight, UFOs. They do have a way of igniting our imagination. Could they possibly be real, though? Well, our David Garcia went to the Nevada desert where people swear they are.
What is it? An airplane? A helicopter? A distant planet? Swamp gas? A weather balloon? A mirage? A UFO? The government tells us there's no such thing as UFOs, just vivid imaginations. But there are those who say it's all a cover-up, especially when it comes to top-secret military installations, such as Area 51 and S4 in the Nevada desert.
We have 9 extraterrestrial craft up there that we have obtained in some manner. Over the last 40 years or so, we probably have 35 or 40 of these, but the 9 that are there, apparently we're back engineering, trying to figure how they work, if we can duplicate the incredibly advanced engineering in them.
A composite photo John Lear took of the Groom Lake complex, roughly 125 miles northeast of Las Vegas, in the middle of the Nevada desert. And this is as close as you'll get without being at least hassled, if not arrested. The base, just on the other side of that mountain range, 18 miles away. We had barely stopped along the highway at a site called Mailbox Road when military security stirred up dust, beating a path toward us. Day 1, they stopped well away and just gave us the once-over. Day 2, they drove right past us as if to say, don't push it. The descriptions vary. Glowing balls of orange or red, hovering lights that change from red to green to blue, piercing white lights. But always, they say, it starts at sunset.
Okay, I got a minute.
First with the usual lens on a television news camera. Now with a night scope. It's the kind of sighting described as common here in the desert, similar to the one that convinced John Lear.
I had my Celestron 8 telescope, and when it stopped for a second and then came down, I focused in on it, and it was a disc, disc-shaped. It was a glowing orange, and it was kind of radiating something, whatever, and it just settled behind the mountain. It was a disc. I saw it, and that's the bottom line.
David Garcia, Channel 4 News, Nightside, in the Nevada desert.
They're out there, John.
Art Bell has become a legacy as a media personality who has been bringing the UFO information to the public on his radio show Coast to Coast AM, where now George Noory is the main host on the show. But Art still comes on, and he's provided an incalculable service in pursuit of disclosure. Michael Eisner, the CEO of the Walt Disney Company, actually was the host introducing a very, very controversial UFO documentary called Alien Encounters in 1999. This was such a hard-hitting documentary and so hot that they never released it throughout the United States. And in the 4 cities where they did release it, it didn't appear in the TV guide, and they never said what time it was going to be on. It appeared at weird times, like 5 in the morning. So those who happened to tune in saw it. I think they used it as sort of an experiment to see how a few people in different areas would react. But Michael Eisner introduced it. It had the, you know, the Disney logo and all of that at the beginning. And Robert Urich was the host of the show. And in it, he made extraordinary claims with the expectation, under the Walt Disney name, that masses of documents proving that extraterrestrials have been visiting the Earth for centuries and actively for the last 50 years were soon going to be released to the American public. The release didn't happen, but I'd like to play for you part of what he said.
Indications are that government, military, and scientific leaders will soon release nearly a half century of official documentation of ongoing alien encounters on Earth. Perhaps they feel it would be too embarrassing not to reveal the truth before the truth reveals itself. But these FBI files acquired through the Freedom of Information Act outline nearly 50 years of UFO reports investigated by federal agents all across America. Overwhelming evidence that something sinister is at work.
But look carefully. The torn pages, the ragged copies, the large areas blacked out in an effort to keep secrets locked away.
If we are keeping information, which I am certain we are, from the American public on unidentified flying objects, then we're wrong. Government has an obligation to the people to tell the truth.
That's Clifford Stone, who's written an excellent book about UFOs. Moving on, Jackie Gleason did tell friends and people I know in the entertainment business that Richard Nixon took him to see the bodies of aliens that had crashed in the Southwest. He saw them at MacDill Air Force Base. It was after a golf game that Gleason played with Nixon. And Gleason was never the same man after that. It shook him up tremendously. He had an enormous collection of UFO literature that he put together after that. His wife has had some comments. His widow has had some comments about this. Interestingly, EG&G, one of the companies that Bob Lazar had mentioned as having been connected with Area 51, when we were researching the movie Roswell, we got a hold of a prospectus for EG&G where they talked about their company's achievements during the 50s and the 60s and on and on. And they had a little photo to represent each era. And for the 1950s, their photo was a photo of Jackie Gleason and the Honeymooners. The National Enquirer, Bob Pratt, he has written some extraordinary stories about UFOs. He was the first to bring to the American public in print, with some help from Stanton Friedman, the Jesse Marcel's story about the crash at Roswell that had been a cover-up, that the initial story that a flying saucer had crashed there was the truth, and that the subsequent story was not true. He's also brought us some other stories that appear to have proven reliable in the National Enquirer. But he, like others, unfortunately, sometimes has been the victim of bait that has been put out by the, Richard Doty of the Air Force Office of Special Investigations put together some false documents on UFOs and seeded the UFO community with them. Author Bill Moore, who co-wrote the original book, Roswell, The Roswell Incident, spoke about that at length at the MUFON International UFO Symposium in Las Vegas. I'm trying to remember the year. I said I was at Nebraska in 89, but 89, was 89 Las Vegas?
Yes.
Yeah, so I think Nebraska may have been 88 then. Leslie Kane, who spoke to you before me today, is one of the journalists with great UFO courage. You heard her story. She was the only journalist in the United States who thought the Cometa report from France was newsworthy. She fought to get it in there. It almost was never released in this country. And I applaud her courage in having done that. The whole story upsets me because it really shows what we're up against, what Steve Bassett calls the truth embargo. I did have the same kind of experience in getting the Roswell incident in getting the movie of the Roswell story made. Billy Cox of Florida Today has done some important reporting on UFOs, including an interview with Edgar Mitchell, one of the 12 astronauts who has walked on the moon. Edgar Mitchell has said publicly he said it over the July 4th weekend. I was there in Roswell this year, that he had a high-level briefing on the UFOs, that there was a crash at Roswell, there were bodies recovered. He doesn't go into the details, but he confirms it, much like Barry Goldwater tried to do. Here's Edgar Mitchell. Oh, this is me in Time magazine at the time of the 1997 50th anniversary of the Roswell incident. I played a photographer in the movie Roswell, photographing the alien bodies. And they used a picture of me to sort of debunk the whole thing, too, and point out that there had been a lot of photography released that was fraud, including the alien autopsy film. Gordon Cooper has let it be known that extraterrestrials are here. You can seek out his book, Leap of Faith. He's done many interviews. In the interest of time, which is narrowing on me, I won't play his affirmation here now, where he describes that ETs are real, but that material is available, and he has said so. One of the early UFO writers, the first from the military, showed great courage, Major Donald Kehoe, in all of his books, purporting the reality of flying saucers and in testifying to an Air Force cover-up on the subject. His book actually became the basis of one of the 1950s B-movies, Earth versus the Flying Saucers. And though a lot of those movies of the 1950s may have been really overdone, and in some cases seemed silly, I think they served a really important purpose in that era. They put the idea out there as to what that could be happening. It gave people food for thought. It planted the seed. And in that sense, I think Hollywood has played a really, really important role in moving the public toward a preparation for disclosure. Ray Harryhausen, who you see here, was the man who did the special effects for Earth versus the Flying Saucers and First Men in the Moon, based on the H.G. Wells novel. I'm completing a film now called The Sci-Fi Boys, which is in part a tribute to Ray Harryhausen and some of the other early pioneers in the genre. This was another one of Ray Harryhausen's interpretations of a space alien, 20 million miles to Earth. An early UFO writer, Frank Scully, reporter for Daily Variety, wrote a book called Behind the Flying Saucers, which was the first book to suggest that a spaceship did crash in the southwest of the United States, that it had been recovered by the military, that there were bodies, and that this was kept secret from the American public. He set it not in Roswell. I can't recall whether he said it was in Aztec or Farmington or where was it? Aztec. And he was resoundingly debunked, as were the men who were his sources, who were arrested as con men after his book came out. They were tried for their role in some oil finding confidence scheme. But it didn't stop Behind the Flying Saucers from becoming a bestseller. Frank Edwards was another one of the important, courageous early voices in saying that flying saucers were real. He was a well-known radio personality and writer of his day in the 50s. Now, in the time I have left, I want to deal with literature, media, Hollywood, some of the contributions that Hollywood has specifically made. I may go through this a little quicker than I intended, but let's go at it. The first two authors to really address the subject in important books, Jules Verne, From the Earth to the Moon. He had very little about aliens there, but he did have just a couple of sentences of speculation that the moon visitors in his book anticipated finding alien beasts on the moon and brought weapons for their protection. H.G. Wells wrote The War of the Worlds, and the first dramatic interpretation of it was by Orson Welles in 1938 in the famous radio broadcast, which is a sort of social experiment. If it proved one thing, it proved that the public could panic if they thought that there was a danger of an invasion from outer space. A lot of people believed that that broadcast was real because of the style in which it was presented. It may have set the process of disclosure back a long way. Now, this was as you see, a decade before Roswell. Roswell hadn't happened yet, but the memory of this would have been fresh in the minds of all those who had to decide what to do about it. We talked about Earth versus the Flying Saucers. It Came from Outer Space was another one of the early ones, written by Ray Bradbury, gave us alien visitation. I'm not going to show this clip, but it is a clip that emphasizes the importance of films such as George Pal's War of the Worlds. George Pal made a great movie based on the H.G. Wells novel. And he deals with Close Encounters of the Third Kind and Men in Black and E.T. The role George Pal played in Hollywood in the 1950s, the late 1940s through the 1950s, cannot be overestimated. He made four important films about space. His Destination Moon, it came out 20 years before the first moon landing, and it really showed step by step in a realistic way how it would be done. It was the public's first exposure to that. His Conquest of Space dealt with a space station, again, for the first time, and a trip to Mars. When Worlds Collide was the basis for two eventual remakes, one called Armageddon and another called Deep Impact. And he produced War of the Worlds. I knew George Pal personally. He gave me one of my first breaks in Hollywood. I wrote a version of The Hobbit for him. We tried to sell The Lord of the Rings. We were ahead of our time, and no one was interested when we took it around. Rod Serling. Yes, The Twilight Zone was science fiction, but he was the host of an important UFO documentary, UFOs Yesterday, Today, and Tomorrow, which dealt with the issue of a possible alien landing at Holloman Air Force Base. One of the key things he said in introducing the segment was, what you are about to see is something that may happen in the future, or it may already have taken place. And there has been speculation on various documentaries that 8 seconds of a UFO shown descending toward Holloman in that documentary may have been from the actual UFO landing. I don't think we have time to see that clip now, but you want to see it. Let's do it. Here it is.
We've so far talked of the past and the present, but what are the possibilities of the future? It seems almost certain that if other beings more advanced than ourselves do inhabit other sectors of the universe, then it's quite probable there will come that day, that moment in time, when official contact will be made. Let's look at an incident that might happen in the future, or perhaps could have happened already. The premise is that contact is made by extraterrestrial beings with representatives of the United States Air Force at Holloman Air Force Base in the deserts of New Mexico. The day is clear. It's about 5:32 a.m. at Holloman Air Force Base. Traffic light. One recon plane is on the field ready for takeoff when Sergeant Mann is given a report of an approaching unidentified craft.
Yeah, Bill, nothing on the
terminal. I'll repeat it again. Unidentified approaching object on coordinate 49-34 degrees southwest following lane 3.
Can I go northeast? Of course. The Army helicopter.
Probably a stray, so yeah, maybe.
Check with Edwards. Make contact with him, Bill.
This is Holloman Air Force.
That's the shot. Put your camera on the screen here.
You're encroaching on military airspace. Warning, identify yourself. You're in a restricted military air corridor.
Call the base commander.
Base commander's office. Sergeant Wilmore speaking.
Yes. Oh, boy. Well, that was the shot. Let's go on. Leonard Nimoy though he was science fiction, Dr. Spock, but he was also a host of the In Search Of program. That was the first documentary television series to present Major Jesse Marcel, showing the Brazel Ranch, where the debris field was that he went to and gathered the remains of the Roswell crash. So he played an important role in UFO history Leonard Nimoy did, by presenting that particular episode. Howard Hawks definitely deserves a mention. The great director of The Thing. I'm talking about the original black and white movie, The Thing, not the John Carpenter remake. This movie, set in the Arctic, was the story of the Roswell crash, but set in the Arctic. And it played out many of the themes of the Roswell crash. It had newsmen there. It had journalists. It had the military. It had the military deciding that this had to be covered up, that word could not get out. The crash flying saucer was under the ice, and there was an alien in the movie. It was still alive. There was a journalist who said, you know, my God, General, you can't cover this up. You can't stop me from sending my my story back. You've got to let me tell the story to the world. And the general's reply was, I'm not working for the world. I'm working for the US Air Force. It was a really important film that came out about the time of Scully's book. I think it was 1950, within a year or so of that. It was just about 3 years after the Roswell incident. William Cameron Menzies, who did some great films, including The Thief of Baghdad. Why mention his Invaders from Mars? Well, think about it. It was a film that had an underground base with aliens, and it had implants. The first time aliens were shown inserting implants into human beings with needles and then completely controlling their behavior, changing their behavior. That was the early 1950s, and it was the first injection of that aspect of ufology into the consciousness of the American public. Here was an absolutely awful movie, Killers from Space. The aliens had ping pong balls for eyes. It was absurd. As a matter of fact, the director was the brother of the great director Billy Wilder. And Billy Wilder saw his movie and he said, my God, I wish you'd stayed in the leather business. But this movie was the concepts in it. We have a pilot who sees a UFO, who blacks out, who has missing time. When he's examined at the base, he has scars on his body. He can't remember how he got them. They use hypnosis to draw out his memory. He remembers having been taken to an underground base, being surrounded by aliens, having been on a table, having been surgically operated upon, having these aliens having tried to take over his mind. Again, this was the first introduction to it to the American public. It was as primitive and cheap as Ed Wood's movie Plan 9 from Outer Space, but it was important in the history of all of this. Ward Kimball, one of the great early animators for Walt Disney, in 1979 came before this International UFO Symposium of MUFON and declared that the US government had approached the Disney Corporation while he was there. They were ready to disclose the reality of aliens. Disney staff, including him, were put to work on it. They were going to be including real footage in the documentary, and then it was abruptly canceled. That was the testimony of Ward Kimball. So he certainly showed courage by appearing before this symposium to say that. F. Lee Bailey, who I worked for, had Betty Hill on his program, as I said. There's the story about Betty Hill. Her abduction was made into a TV film, and she was found to be truthful in the polygraph. Now, the polygraph was given by this man, Ed Gelb, who was a partner to F. Lee Bailey on the TV show on which I was a segment producer. Ed Gelb was involved in the Travis Walton case, which later became the movie Fire in the Sky. That abduction case had many witnesses. I think there were six logger witnesses to the Travis Walton abduction. Ed Gelb polygraphed them all. And he announced on tape that they were all truthful. And he said, he was president of the American Polygraph Society. He said the chances of six people beating the polygraph on something like this was smaller than one chance in a million. So there's another profile in UFO courage, Ed Gelb, the polygrapher. Tracy Torme certainly deserves to be noted for writing the script of Fire in the Sky, for having written the NBC miniseries Intruders based upon the work of the great abduction researcher Bud Hopkins, who we've been so privileged to have here at this symposium. Tracy Torme went on to do the TV series Sliders. Shirley MacLaine established her reputation as a great actress and then went very far out on a limb. She was ridiculed by Mike Wallace on CBS when she admitted to her belief in aliens. Do they visit you on your porch? He asked her sarcastically. And he savaged her belief in karma and reincarnation, too. She has revealed having extensive film footage of the UFOs in Mexico from the last decade, and she's shown a lot of courage in coming forward and subjecting herself to that degree of ridicule. Robert Stack was important as the host of Unsolved Mysteries, a show which brought us many cases, including a half hour on the Roswell case. I think they had Rendlesham Forest. They may have also had Kecksburg. Mike Farrell was the host of an important one-hour documentary called UFO Cover-Up Live that had a lot of major sponsors, including Bell Telephone, I think AT&T, other Fortune 500 companies. It had a live hookup to a ufologist in Russia. It had testimony from Paul Schardel, Air Force audiovisual specialist, about that Holloman Air Force Base landing footage that I just showed you that was hosted by Rod Serling. Paul Schardel said on that show that that 8 seconds was real, that it came from the actual landing, that no one had either paid for that footage or contrived it or filmed it as a special effect. He made this statement on UFO Cover-Up Live. Unfortunately, that documentary did have some disinformation. It had the secret agents Condor and Falcon, who were involved with Richard Doty, talking about how the aliens liked Tibetan music and strawberry ice cream. And everyone laughed at the strawberry ice cream, and it seemed to dismiss everything valid you'd heard on the show. Dan Aykroyd, we've heard a lot about this weekend. He is an important sponsor of MUFON now, and he is to be applauded for all of his contributions and support for this field. Whitley Strieber had a breakthrough book with Communion, which really, having been on the bestseller list of the New York Times for so many weeks, and having shown that face of a gray alien to the public, and told the story of his abduction in a very realistic way, which people could really identify with, that he said was his true story, it had a very cathartic and important effect throughout the country. Linda Moulton Howe, Emmy award-winning television producer, An Alien Harvest. It was the show she won the Emmy for, dealing with cattle mutilation and the speculation of alien involvement. She went on to write a couple of important books. I just have a few more here, people to cover before we wrap up. Chris Carter and the X-Files, the truth is out there. He told us that again and again and again, week after week, and gave us really compelling stories that made us think about what was fact and what was fiction. Gillian Anderson, Dana Scully, in X-Files, said she watches the skies looking for the aliens, and she publicly admits to being a full-fledged believer. The name of FBI agent Scully in that show, of course, comes from Frank Scully, the author of Behind the Flying Saucers, who I talked to you about a few moments ago. Barry Sonnenfeld brought us a contribution with Men in Black. Though it was a comedy, it was a wonderful, sardonic, sarcastic, biting comedy, which really made the point of the lengths that the government could go to keep the presence of aliens on Earth secret. And again, I think that that laughter was a great cathartic effect nationally. It further p- paving the way for people being ready for disclosure. Arthur C. Clarke. He's hosted a lot of skeptical UFO documentaries. He wrote 2001, A Space Odyssey. He has been a skeptic throughout his life, but he's announced within the last couple of years he's convinced now not just that there was life on Mars, but that there is life on Mars presently. He believes he's seen the evidence in NASA's own photographs, and he's done a complete 180 degrees turnaround and stated that publicly, for which many of his old friends at NASA have ridiculed him. Now, why would I mention Carl Sagan, one of the arch skeptics who always kept saying extraordinary claims require extraordinary evidence? And that statement is true, of course. He gave us a great gift in his series Cosmos. His book Contact and the film that came from it were an important expression from the heart. Fictionalized, but showed the commitment that he'd shown to SETI all his life and his earnestness in the importance of contact, a contact he felt had not taken place. He didn't believe that there was a cover-up, or at least he said he didn't. But I think the one particular contribution I can point to after all of his skepticism was that in his final book before his death, The Demon-Haunted World, he reversed course, urging NASA to re-photograph the face on Mars after having belittling it and fighting with Richard Hoagland and the other researchers and dismissing it. He said, it is a testable hypothesis, and we can get an answer to it, and therefore we should. And NASA apparently reversed course based on his recommendation, and he was pointing the right course, that when it's possible for us to get the evidence through photography, we have an obligation to do it. And that was his last statement before his death, and I applaud him for it. And so I list him in this too. Lastly, but not least, of those I have been able to think of to include in this, and I'm sure there are many others, Gene Roddenberry, others I haven't specifically included, and we'll all be talking for months, I hope, about who deserves a profile in UFO courage. Steven Spielberg, I have, to end this presentation, a kind of a rare clip of Steven Spielberg and J. Allen Hynek.
A young Steven Spielberg, Richard Dreyfuss, and government UFO researcher Dr. J. Allen Hynek explain the terminology of close encounters.
Well, a close encounter of the first kind is one is close, but nothing really happens.
A close encounter of the first kind is visible contact with a UFO.
Forget the shape and forget how fast it's going. It's something that you just can't explain.
Close encounters of the second kind are those which leave a physical trace. Holes in the ground.
Burn rings.
Broken tree branches.
Telephone lines down.
Animals disturbed.
Stopping of car engines.
And the close encounters of the third kind are the most interesting of all.
Close encounter of the third kind. When you meet him.
Close encounter of the third kind is when you meet him. So there you have it. A lot of people who did step forward and show courage on this incident, on this subject, on the entire matter of UFOs. And just think, if we had a little courage today in Congress, in the Senate, in the presidency, if any of them had the kind of courage that all of these people have shown, we would come to next year's MUFON Symposium not to rail against the cover-up and the distortions that have been told, and not to have to plead for disclosure, but to have an entire weekend of pure celebration. Let's see a little bit more courage. Thanks. Thanks to all of you. I'll shut down after you wrap up.
In lieu of taking a break before the closing, we're just going to go ahead and go right into this. I, unfortunately, this was the time of the weekend that I was not looking forward to. I had so much fun being up here and was honored to take the position of being the MC this year. It's the first time I've ever done this. So hopefully, thank you. Thank you very much. Hopefully, you know, everything went very smoothly. We got so much information this weekend. I do really want to recognize, and I'm only thanking two people, so this won't take long, the AV staff and crew. I mean, they were unbelievable. They made all this technology possible, so. And then just the last person that I really do want to thank, and there's a list of them, so please, you know who you are, who I would thank you. But I think the person that I really have a high respect for was one of the two people that asked me to do this, Mr. John Schuessler, who's the international director, who you can truly tell has two things. He has passion, and he has direction, and he's doing that, and he's definitely accomplished a lot, and he's accomplishing a lot. So I want to say thank you for asking me to do this. Lynn as well, thank you. And unfortunately, I have to pass the mic to John. So thank you guys very much. All right, you guys have a good night.
Well, John certainly has my thanks. He's done a terrific job this weekend, as has everybody else. The Colorado MUFON crew has been working for weeks getting this ready, and they never left their post this whole weekend. I hope you will all give them a round of applause. And I also want to thank the AV crew. Bob and Terry Brown of UFO Congress have done the most outstanding job we could have asked for, and the tapes are available. They'll be selling them afterwards. We will put the notices on the website. If you want to get any of the speakers, you know where they come from. We also have the symposium proceedings book. It's available to you. It has the speakers' talks in it in written form. They're on our table out there, and we have another box full of them that we can still sell today. I am just overwhelmed by how well it went this weekend. It's been such a positive event, a lot of good energy, a lot of good things have come out of it. We've established a lot more coalitions between people and groups. We have projects planned now that we didn't have planned before we went into the weekend, and it's all going to bode well for the UFO research and for what you get to hear the next time around. And on that note, I'd like to turn this over to Lynn, our symposium chairperson, who I think has done a most superb job, and I want to give her a chance to thank you all also.
Thank you all, of course, for being here. I mean, what more can I say? This has been wonderful, and I've thoroughly enjoyed it. I hope all of you have as well. But I want to welcome you to next year's 36th Annual Symposium for MUFON, which will also be here in Denver. And it will be held in the Marriott at the Denver Tech Center. They are actually selling this property this year, a couple of months after we leave. So it's just going to be a little further south down the road off of I-25 in the Denver Tech Center, July 21st through the 24th. So please mark your calendars and be looking for the website in a couple of months. And please tell everyone to come. Thank you. And here's Leslie.
Ladies and gentlemen, please stand by for our closing ceremonies.
Ladies and gentlemen, may I have your attention, please? Thank you for attending the Internal Revenue Service's seminar on 1040 ET. Thank you.